Hey guys, welcome to Great North Nerd, and this is my first interview here. And why don't you introduce yourself?
Hey, my name is Jeff Rubin, and I'm the host of the extraordinarily popular podcast, The Jeff Rubin, Jeff Rubin Show.
Extraordinarily popular, and also very varied in topics. You've done things from past NFL cheerleaders to pizza connoisseurs. What gave you the inspiration to start something like this of such just a broad range of subjects? Like, I've never really seen that before.
I don't know. I mean, you know, it's funny you mentioned the pizza connoisseur because you are referring to my friend Scott, who runs a company called Scott's Pizza Tours, and he gives pizza tours of New York. Scott has been one of my best friends since very, very young. I recently posted a clip on Vimeo of us like performing a Weird Al lip sync together at summer camp. And he does this pizza tour thing. And he, you know, I started a podcast. I guess I figured I wanted to interview some people because I had done some of that and it was fun. And of course, he was one of the first people on my mind. And it's one of the very first episodes I recorded, though I think it's like maybe the third one I released. And I don't know, Scott to me is like was really like a model of like the kind of person I wanted to talk to, who I think Scott's so interesting and so fun and has so many interesting things to say, and it's just like such a pleasure to listen to for an hour. And I'm very fortunate to know him, but I was like, I guess I had a sense that there were other people out there like this, and that, I don't know, kind of provided a model. And then I guess my own interests are broad, right? Like, I think the thing I'm probably a lot of people know me from, I guess, is like I did a lot of video game stuff at College Humor. And
you're the host of Bleep Loop.
I'm the host of Bleep Loop. So, and I like talk about video games on Twitter, and I am really into video games. But I'm also into other things. And ooh, even though I'm not like into the NFL, I think nothing. And I never would watch. It's boring. It's just boring. Like, I don't begrudge you if you're into it. It's just like not interesting.
No. Trust me, I'm in the same boat.
But I would say that like there are elements of the game, or of the production at least, of the whole thing that I think are interesting. Like I had a cheerleader on, but I also had a sports photographer on earlier in the year.
I remember that one. It was really interesting how he just the dynamics of it, like every single camera working all together.
Yeah, so, like, to me, I think that's really interesting, and, like, I don't have to be interested in football to think that's interesting. Like, I see at the football game lots of little interesting things going on. And I guess I'm into, like, unsung heroes, maybe, and, like, people who, like, I try to find people who haven't really been interviewed all over the place. I guess
you always get the stars, but you never actually get the production team.
Yeah, I like interviewing people, and it's not like a strict rule, and it's not required, but I like interviewing people who have never been interviewed before on another podcast. To me, that's like a really good thing, actually, like, because, I don't know, I just think that's interesting and fun to try to find interesting people out there. And it's just like, I don't know, of the people you could think of, like, I don't know, let's say David Byrne. I really like Talking Heads, and like I want to interview David Byrne. Like, everyone wants to interview David Byrne. Everyone loves Talking Heads. It's like hard to get David Byrne. He's very busy and like, you know, all these things. Whereas like, I don't know, if you the world palindrome champion, who was a great guest, and I don't mean to throw shade on him in any way, shape, or form. I love that cast. It's one of my favorite episodes. But it's just like, he's probably less busy. He's more gettable than David Byrne, I would say. You know?
Well, it's the people who are very approachable. Like you were fantastic with handling it. Like, I messaged you, responded within an hour, I think, and you guided me through it a little bit. And obviously, I a little bit nervous first episode, but it's finding people who can easily. Nobody knows what they're gonna say. Because there might be people who have been interviewed before, and you'll know what they're going to say. You know, how they're going to respond to all these questions, because they've answered these things dozens of times.
Well, I would say that you reached out to the right person, because I spend a great deal of time bothering people on the internet asking if I can interview them on my podcast. So I am very sympathetic when I receive such a request. And, you know, like, I can't be bothering people all the time and, like, not be and not reply when someone such as yourself reaches out to me. That'd be insane. That's rude.
Yeah. But, yeah. So when people hear the name Jeff Rubin, they're probably
What do they think? I don't know.
The sandwich, first off. Also, college humor.
Sure. Yeah.
I know... It's probably not the most interesting. Well, actually, no. Is it the most interesting subject, or would you prefer to kind of, you know, keep that career behind you?
Oh, no. It was a wonderful time, and I love it, and I'm still very good friends with all those people. And, you know, I would never. I guess I haven't done it for a few years now.
Well, it's been 3 years, I think. Yeah, three years. Yeah,
wow. So that sounds right. Yeah, geez. It was.
And then, yeah, you spent 5 years working there.
No, I spent 9 years working there.
No, yeah.
So yeah, you know, like, I guess it is behind me or whatever, but I'll probably, you know, I think probably I get like emails or recognized for it less and less, which is fine. Like, anytime, it was always a pleasure and like always nice people and blah blah blah. And but it's less and less, which is fine. But I probably think it will. I'd be nice. Maybe I'm being optimistic. It probably will go on for a while. Less and less. Less and less and less and less. But
pushed back and back and back in the
video.
Yeah, like,
I guess people still discover it, and I'm always pleased to hear that. I guess I'm very proud of the work we did.
Oh, some of the videos I'm still watching. It's the comedy value of it. It doesn't matter if these games were outdated even when you made these videos. They're just entertaining. They're personalities.
Yeah, so it was a real treat, and like, I'm very flattered that people watch it and enjoy it, and I'll like never be mad to talk about it or whatever.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to talk about like college humor in general. What would you think was your favorite sketch or series or something like that to work on?
Oh, sure. Well, I mean, it's probably almost, obviously it's the thing you already mentioned, which was Bleep Bloop, just because that was the thing that I owned the hardest. And like, you know, not only was I in it, but I was also like editing those and effectively.
Yeah. Did you
producing.
Have complete creative control? Or?
I think so. Yeah. I think like maybe sometimes I was asked to keep it's funny. It's funny. I think yes. I'd say essentially yes. Like, I certainly no one really gave a shit enough or cared to tell me to do or not to do something. I think like I had to like color within the lines, you know, but like I would say I mean, look, I got to make a show where like it was essentially like me playing video games with my friends. So like yeah I had creative control over that.
Yeah. And I know you still talk with Pat Castles and,
sure. I hung out with him just, what's today, Tuesday? The other night we went out with some other friends and we saw The Arrival, which was great.
So yeah, how exactly was the process for doing the other show?
The other show I did at College Humor?
Sorry, I have my notes here. It's at the very top where my pencil is.
No worries.
Nerd Alert, sorry.
Yeah, it's all good. So what's the question though? What was the process for doing Nerd Alert?
Well, like it's a much different format than Bleep Bloop.
Yeah, I guess the idea was like, sorry, keep going. I interrupted you.
It's okay. I interrupted you. So what with making Nerd Alerts, did it have the same just you and a few people, or was this more top brass, you know, sending you out to do these things kind of thing?
No, it was still me and a few people. I think that one was a little more written, though I guess I tried to, as I recall, maintain some element of the unscriptedness of it, but it was just a little more formatted and a little more rigid. It was also topical, which meant it, like, had to be, like, turned around faster, which meant it, like, had to be a little more, just the process had to be different. But, like, you know, the great thing about working there and was that, like, I mean, the inmates were sort of running the asylum, you know? And
yeah.
So, like, I mean, which is to say that there was brass and people were I don't know, like, there was no, like, executive who was, like, giving me notes on these things, just because, I mean, honestly, they weren't the flagship product, first of all. I don't know what was, but it was, like, weird. I mean, I don't know if anyone even watched it. It was, like, it was just us playing video games.
Like, sorry, Nerd Alert or Bleep Bloop?
I guess either, like, yeah. You know, well, it was, like, my own weird thing, and it was just my own weird thing, I would say, to the side. And people let me do whatever I want. It was a pleasure.
Well, from what I've seen, at least from the viewership and from what my own friends have said, Bleep Bloop is actually, at least on a personal level, not necessarily, you know, in a outward marketing level, all that stuff, probably one of the College Humor classics.
Oh, well, that's I don't know. I guess that's nice to hear. I mean, look, we did it for a long time. So, I don't, you know, like, it's just like you get... you just get beaten into you get beaten into acceptance, because if you just keep releasing them, you eventually just get used to it, and you're like, yeah, this is a classic. They've been doing this a while. I mean, that's nice to hear. I appreciate that, and like, I think, you know, if to me, like, what's nice about hearing that is that we were all having a very good time working together, and
well, it always felt very natural.
Yeah, and I like hope that. And I think if the show is at all good or watchable, it's like because of that. It like I was hoping to, you know, like, and I think the show reflects that. So it's not only was it a nice thing that I'm proud of and I'm glad people enjoyed, but like it sort of reflects the good times I myself was having working there and with those people. So it was it's a nice compliment to hear. Thank you.
You're welcome. So what do you? Have you been keeping up with College Humor's newer casts at all?
You know, I watch the videos, and I can't say I don't know that I know like every single thing they do. It's just hard to keep up with anyone online. But I'm pretty good about it, and I've met probably most of them socially, and I think they're really funny. Yes, I'd say yes.
Looping all the way back. As far as the internet is concerned, you went from College Humor, and then you went started doing your podcast, and then you went to BuzzFeed. What was your sort of work there?
So let me straighten out the timeline a little bit for the internet. One is I started the podcast while I was at College Humor, and I probably did it for like, I don't know, 2 years while I was working there. I'm not sure even. I mean, the podcast, God bless it. I love it, and I take it seriously, and I enjoy the hell out of it. I'm glad you enjoy it and other people enjoy it. But it was like not a – I've been working other jobs at the same time, let's say. Mm. So I left College Humor, and I went and I worked at BuzzFeed, what was then called BuzzFeed Video, and was later called BuzzFeed Motion Pictures, and is now, I think, BuzzFeed Entertainment Group. And
sounds about right.
I worked So, which is to say, I worked in the LA BuzzFeed office making videos. And I made videos, and it was really fun and cool. And I mean, BuzzFeed has a really cool, interesting thing going on there where a lot of people who make online videos basically make a worse version of what's on TV. They do it the same way that's on TV, but they just do it worse. You get like worse, you get like cheaper lighting and cheaper editors and just cheaper. It's just like a cheaper version of TV. But BuzzFeed, I think, is really like built a better mousetrap, and it was really fun and exciting to work there. I got to make videos, really. Google, I made a post after I left that to of my favorite videos that I made there. So if you look for, I don't know, some combination of like Jeff Rubin BuzzFeed videos, it's on Medium. That would probably be the thing that'll really help you find it. It's on medium.com. You can see some of the stuff I did there, and it was really a treat, and I learned so much. I mean, you're like writing and directing and editing and producing and like color correcting and just like really soup to nuts everything in your video. And you know, I learned a lot of technical skills and a lot of internet skills and everything. And I was, you know, and it was cool and interesting, and the people were wonderful, and it was great. And I was there for a year or two. I worked there for a year or two, and then I moved back to New York to start working at YouTube.
Oh, that's good. I won't get into that much, but what we will get into is kind of looping back to the podcast. So when you get these people, do you find it that some of them are a little bit harder to, like, what kind of people are harder to get a hold of than others? Or are they all very, you know, as you said, approachable?
Great question. Well, older people are more difficult, I would say, because they are less likely, especially, I'd say, people who aren't active on social media, because that's the main way I'm going to find you. And that is a lot, generally old people, but not always, obviously, but just like, you know, old people are, older people generally spend less time on social media for some reason. So, you know, yeah, they're usually harder to reach, but, or people who work at companies. I usually, like, I interview a lot of people, like, after the fact, and it's like, there's an, almost a nostalgia element to it, but it's just so that, I don't know. They can talk about things, you know, and like,
well, they don't want to step on the wrong toes while they're talking.
Right. I've talked to some cool, I've had some cool people. I kind of probably can't say who, but who would like wanted to do it, but were currently working for something that wouldn't allow, that like would open up this can of worms and like, and so that, those are kind of some of the difficulties I run into. I'll say just because I feel like I was vague. It was a technical consultant for a cool TV show. A cool TV show that's about a cool thing. And there was a technical consultant that, like, helped them figure out how to do the cool thing. And I thought that, like, I really like technical consultants. One of, like, my favorite go-to episodes of my own podcast is when people, like, ask me, like, what's an example? I always talk about the linguist who invented Dothraki, which is, like, was, like, another eureka moment for me. I was like, yes, more like these. and this is someone who had, like, a similar role like that on another show. But, like, the show and the entity that controlled it was less cool about him talking about, you know, kind of his job.
Yeah, well, bigger productions like to keep tight-knit. Yeah, the podcast itself, what would you, like, say is the most, like, what sort of topics do you have the most fun talking about? Is it more, is everything, you know, a good experience, or do you prefer, like, the, do you prefer people like, well, your friend, the pizza connoisseur, or the talking about the production side of things, or, you know, talking about the nostalgia with, what's the toy, what's those toys called again? The stuffed animals?
Beanie babies.
Thank you.
So I don't know. I don't know if there's a type. There's definitely some. I mean, look, like, it's my show, and like, I do it for as a hobby for fun, and it's like a hobby I take very seriously. But it's just to say, like, if they're on the show, I want to be talking to them, and I'm excited about
that's
it. Like,
fair.
I'm not like,
you have creative control. It's never going to be a boring episode for
right
me.
right. Like, I just, like, I don't have to be doing this, so like, I'm not gonna do it unless it's someone I'm excited about. So everyone on the show is someone I'm excited about. Some I would say I'm more excited about. There's some who, it's not like some I'm more excited about than others, that like I could rank them all but on 1 to 10, but there's some that I just like, I can't wait to talk to, and like, as soon as I sit down to think about questions, I have to like sit down and like, it's like writing. You got to like really think about it, what you want to talk about. But sometimes I sit down, like I just immediately have 100 questions, and those are the ones I'm really excited about.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Obviously I am scurrying for questions. I did write things down, but, how, like you said, hundreds, is that literal or...
What did I say hundreds in reference to?
Questions for the people.
Oh, like, no. I said hundreds just now?
I think so. I'm pretty sure.
No, that's not right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I said I'd have hundreds of questions. Yeah, I wouldn't really.
An exaggeration.
Yeah. I wouldn't say hundreds, but I just like have sufficient questions immediately. What's sufficient? I don't know. You know, I don't know. I kind of know... I kind of know how much room it takes up in a text document. It's probably like, it depends. That's a good question. It's probably like 20 to 30, depending on how in-depth they are. I also like to have backups. Like, I like to like really be thorough in my thinking, because sometimes like the backups are actually become the primaries, and like the thing I'm like, some weird detail is like the thing I'm actually really interested in. No, I wouldn't. It's not that. It's just that... I don't know. It's just like some weird detail. I'm trying to think of a good example of this. Boy, who's been on the show recently? I haven't really, like, I've actually been behind in recording, so I haven't really interviewed someone. Let me pull up the list real quick.
No worries.
Oh, a major league okay, great example. I interviewed speaking of sports, I interviewed an umpire. We were speaking about sports a while ago. I interviewed an umpire, and like,
we've been all over the place this interview.
I had a lot of questions about umpiring. And like, it's pretty easy to think of questions for umpire. It's like a pretty interesting job, I think, anyway. Yeah. But I'll tell you one that came to me at the very end, and I actually don't know that it came to me. I think a friend suggested it, but it's like a really detailed and great question. It was like the one, actually, you know who came up with it? It was Jake Hurwitz. Jake Hurwitz. Huh. I don't know why I was talking about it, but Jake actually suggested this question, which was, do you ever, like, what did he say? Like, are you ever, like, it was something to the extent of, are you ever secretly rooting for one team or, like, hoping it's a ball or a strike? It was a little more elegant than that. Let me look up what it was real quick.
Yeah.
But to me, like, just the idea that, like, just that opened up this whole, hold on, I got it.
Oh.
Oh, wait.
Oh, you're actually opening a text document?
No, I'm looking at the email to see, because we communicate. I feel like we communicate over an email. I can't find it though. Anyway,
oh, it's all
right. Jake just, I think, suggested talking to him about if, and I'm sure it's in the episode. It was if just something about like if he rooted for the other team or if he was ever like secretly hoping it was a strike. No, I got it. I'm sorry it took me a minute to get here, but it's gonna be worth it. The question was, does he ever enjoy yelling strike three and like hearing the crowd like cheer for him, like calling a third strike against the visiting team? Does he like enjoy that? Does he like get any joy out of that? And like, it just kind of, I thought the idea, that's like a really detailed question. Like, it's not the first question you think of when you think of umpires, I think, but I think it's a really interesting one. It like opens up this whole vein of like, I don't know, just the crowd reacting and like him playing to the crowd and like, so, which is just to say that, like, I try to come up with more than I need to make sure I'm getting the good ones, and I'm rigorous in my preparation.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I need to work on. So yeah, the
also I'd say, and here's a tip for you. Sometimes I write 20, and like it takes like 10 minutes. Like, you know, like some people are just short. Some people, authors, are really good at this. Like, you can just be like, what's the deal with this thing? And just, like, scratch, like, lean back and play a game on your iPhone and let them talk for 10 minutes. But some people, and I don't know, it's like a type or whatever. And it's not, like, a criticism of the people, but, like, some people are just more contrite. And I look at a list of questions, and I see them, like, halfway through after 10 minutes, and I'm like, oh, boy, we're gonna have to do some dancing today and, like, figure
the,
out.
The kind of person who sends one-word texts.
Yeah, it's not even like, yeah, and it's not a judgment of them, and like, it's my, it's on me to ask good questions, and like, it's cool, and like, I don't think those episodes are any better or worse. It's just like a different style of conversation, and you know, like, and also I am getting people who are not experienced interviewees, you know, necessarily, so sometimes it just takes a little digging, but you know, it's fun.
Well, I always get there, A few final questions for you.
Hit me.
So one last one that pertains to your work. As far as anybody listening to this who wants to be a writer, a comedian, maybe an actor, do you have any tips for the process of writing as far as comedy goes?
No, I mean, I definitely don't have any acting tips, that's for sure. I would say the advice that I always give for basically anything, and it's like common advice, I'm not a genius, is to like just start doing it. You know, if you like whatever it is, like if you just start doing it, you're immediately ahead of like, let's say 50% of people who say they're gonna do it, probably more, you know. And yeah, if you just like work on it a little harder, like most people who say they want to do it, and I'm not talking about comedy writing, I'm talking about whatever it is you're thinking about doing, most people who say they want to do it, like, don't actually take the steps to do it. And you might be one of those people right now. So you got to actually take the steps to do it and just start doing it. And there's a really great, I think it's Ira Glass. I'm not a huge Ira Glass. I like him quite a bit, but I'm not, like, quoting him often. But he did write a thing that I find myself thinking about sometimes about how, when you start doing something, you're just bad at it. And, like, because you started doing the thing that, like, you're obviously a discerning customer of the thing. You were interested enough in it to start doing it yourself. So you recognize that what you're doing is not up to snuff. You know it's bad because you like whatever, you like the thing enough to be doing it. And you can see there's this gap between, like, what you're imagining and what you want to do and what you're currently doing. And, basically that everyone sees that, everyone gets that, and you have to just kind of work through that. And, like, that's just, like, a step on the way. It's just, like, not unusual. That's just, like, one of the steps is, like, kind of working through that.
Yeah.
He said it so much more elegantly in, like, 15, like, beautiful words. And, like, none of them were in the sentiment I laid out. And you won't be able to Google it based on what I told you. Maybe if you look for Ira Glass advice, it's pretty well shared and you'll find it. But it is... Regardless of what he actually said, that is how I remember it, and I think that holds true for basically whatever it is you want to do.
Yeah, basically, if you're interested in it, keep doing it, you're going to get better.
Yeah, I mean, just start doing it. Like, here we are, this is your podcast. Like, yeah,
exactly.
We're recording the first one right now, and now you're like, now the it's next one's a little easier, and like, you're getting, I'm sure, I hope, I imagine you have like a lot of ideas already for like what you want to do. For the next
I've asked
one.
Tons of people.
But also just like, you know, I imagine you'll have very soon, now that you've done it, you've done this first one, you will very soon have ideas for things that you want to build on that we talked about, new things you want to try, and like all these things that like you couldn't have wrapped your head around before you started. But now that you started, you're like on the path to making the thing you want to make.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's been a daunting little bit of time. So going into a more general sense, between your work and your podcast and all that, do you have much time for video games nowadays?
Yeah, I do. I definitely do. Yeah. Is the question going to be, what am I playing?
Most definitely.
All right. Really into Overwatch. I did a little Civ 6-ing when Civ 6 came out. I beat Civ 6. Got a feel for it. For Civ 6?
I guess it is Civ 6, yes.
Civ 6 is the new one that came, and it came out like a week or two ago.
Yeah.
Maybe 3 weeks ago now, but it is...
Sounds about right.
I love that game, and it's good, and I beat it once or twice. You know, a Civilization playthrough takes like probably 7 to 10 hours, so...
Depending.
Right. And so, I gave it a good run or two. I'm gonna wait till they like update it a little. But I like
it's,
that a lot.
From what I've heard, it's a bit kind of clunky in some areas, but
it's true.
As far as a Civilization launch game, it seems like it's the best one yet, which is kind of saying something about the Civilization series.
It's true. You know, I've loved the Civilizations. This is probably the first one I've played at launch, though. I played like 2 and 3 when I was, I mean, 2, I would have been so young, and 3 a little maybe in high school. But I never really played 4, and then I only came back to 5. I just thought I didn't like it anymore, but I only came back to 5 after the final expansion, Brave New World, was out. And my understanding is that, or Gods and Kings, whatever, both of them were out at that time. And my understanding is, like, the game wasn't really great until both of those were added. So this is my first time playing a Civ game at launch, and... I definitely see a few rough edges. Truth is, I'm not really good enough at Civ to like really know exactly what the problems are, but there's some problems. But like, I'll tell you, it totally cast its Civilization spell on me. That game is unlike any other video game. It just puts you in this trance state where like
just
time
one more turn.
Has no meaning. It's crazy. Like it's just crazy. It affects me like no other game, and it's the new one's pretty good. I enjoyed it. I dug it. And I'm looking forward to seeing what they do more with it. So that Overwatch and I got Titanfall 2, which is, I'm playing the single player, and it's really good. The single player is really good. I think it's short. I'm afraid I'm going to beat it soon. I think the multiplayer, it's probably not going to be something I get super into because, to be honest, it's like a miracle I'm playing Overwatch multiplayer. Like, I'm not It just seems unlikely I'm going to get into, like, this
mobile. You're kind of more of a single-player kind of person?
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm nearly 35 years old, so I'm just, like, not good at playing video games online. But Overwatch is tuned such that I actually can be okay at playing Overwatch because it's got some fun characters who are not just about Twitch aiming and, like, they're, you know, and, yeah.
It's Overwatch a lot more forgiving than some other games.
Yeah, and I've played it enough now that, like, even some of the DPS characters, like Soldier or whoever, I can, like, be competent at. It's even those characters, except, like, Genji, who's, like, sort of a robo-ninja, and, like, McCree, who's, like, a space cowboy with, like, a six-shooter. Like, they require, like, really high... Those are, like, the high skill cap characters. But yeah. Other than those, like, you know, I can be competent with most of the people. Like, the other characters are less difficult to play than Titanfall 2 is, and then most multiplayer shooters are. Like, most of the characters in Overwatch are not as... It's still interesting and very fun to play, and, like, there's all these fun things, but a lot of the things that make it fun aren't just, like, Twitch shooting. Like, it is in Call of Duty. Twitch shooting, wonderful. God bless you if that's what you enjoy. I'm just not my thing right now.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. On Titanfall... there was a very, very big outcry about the size of the game during the first one, not necessarily in content, but in actual file size. It ate up a computer's memory and all the system's memories, like it was absolutely nothing. Do you find that it did the same thing for the second one, or did that more or less get ironed out?
I never played the first one. I've only played the second one, and I've barely played the multiplayer, and I've only played the single player. But the single player is excellent. It's actually, like, very creative, and there's lots... I mean, it's got the central Titanfall gameplay hook of, like...
Hardcore parkour.
Plus... Oh, is that what they call it? Like, is that their...
No. That was a lame joke.
It's good, though. I like it. That's catchy. It's, like, very... It's good. Yeah, it's got just that central... It's got that plus... giant robot. So, like, half the time you're, like, this agile, nimble, like, you know, ninja kind of space marine. And then the other half, you're, like, a big lumbering robot. And, like, the combination of the two, that's inherently, like, a pretty good idea. But they add tons of little interesting twists and cool hooks in the single player. And it's pretty impressive, actually. Like, I kind of wish they had done more of it instead of the multiplayer. But I'm probably... Not probably
going to stop after the single player.
I'll probably try the multiplayer. It's just like, I don't think I'm going to be very good at it. And it's just not as interesting. Like, the single player is actually like, it's not like just that this is the only way I can enjoy Titanfall 2. It's actually a really good single player game with lots of cool, interesting gameplay hooks and great level design. So, so I probably will stop, but you know, I'll keep an eye on it.
All right. Being the host of Bleep Bloop, having played, as you've said, many games over your life, what would you say is your, not necessarily what you think the best game is, what is your favorite? It doesn't matter if it's nostalgic or not, what is your favorite game?
Yeah, it's probably, the top five are all probably on Super Nintendo, and it's probably Mario World. Yeah, it's actually almost definitely Mario World. Maybe other the short list top of my head is Mario World, Link to the Past, Puzzle Fighter 2, which is actually I'm an interesting nerd answer. Puzzle Fighter 2, that's a PlayStation 1 era game. Psychonauts, I really love. What else? I don't know. That's I guess those are the ones that come to that really jump to mind and like really great. I guess maybe Rock Band / Amplitude I would put there. I love Eco and Shadow of the Colossus are all-time classics for me, and I'm really looking forward to playing Last of the Guardian. I can't believe I'm saying this, a few weeks, and I'm really looking
forward. Yeah, who ever thought of that?
I love Braid. I love The Witness. I think those are all-timers for me. It's funny, I said they're all Super Nintendo games, but then I named not a lot of Super Nintendo games.
Yeah. What do you think of, like, the slow shift that's newer system video games have been going towards more cinematic than strict gameplay aspects? Like The Order compared to, well, Mario World.
I never played The Order. I would say the games I really enjoy, I don't really enjoy story-based games, or cinematic is, like, not really a quality I seek in my video games. Like, I seek that in my movies, and, like, it's just because it's, like, there are cinematic games I like, but, like, that's really not what I go to video games for. I go to games that are fun to play. Like, I like doing shit. I like when I get to, like, be making interesting decisions all the time. I once read gameplay defined as number of interesting decisions you get to make over the amount of time you're playing, and that really rings true for me. Like, to me, it's like how much fun, like, I just want to be doing shit all the time. And Portal, I'd add Portal, I'd add Portal and Half-Life 2. I can't say I'd add Team Fortress to my all-time favorite list. I love Team Fortress, but the Portals and Half-Life 2 are up there for me too. Which is, I bring those up to say those are great games that are cinematic and have great story, but, like, you're never also not doing, like, you never, your foot's never off the gas. Like, you're always doing something fun and interesting when you play those games. So that's, like, really what I like. I actually really don't like games, like, role-playing games. There's not many role-playing games I like. I do dig Mass Effect, but...
Well, that has amazing gameplay.
Yeah.
And the story.
I think Mass Effect, one, is I'm a sucker for science fiction, and... Two is they found a really interesting way to make the story part of the gameplay, I thought. Like, and the way you have to, like, make snap decisions sometime with the Renegade or Paragon thing is makes it so that, like, you're never really sitting down and just watching the movie. Like, you might be asked to be an active participant in it at moment's notice, which sounds like a terrible... Like, I'm saying that, and that sounds boring, but the Mass Effect writing is good enough, and the decisions you have to make are interesting enough that... That game totally hooked me. I love Mass Effect. I can't wait for the next one.
Oh, yeah, they're making a next one. Except this one's not actually a continuation of the story.
I guess it's a reboot, but I don't know. You know, I used to, when I had more time, I loved the Baldur's Gate series, so BioWare's, and Knights of the Old Republic. So I always thought of BioWare as, like, they make the RPGs I like, so I was glad to get into their new thing, you know?
Yeah. So you like video games, obviously, but what are your thoughts on the, I'm just going to list off three different subjects, and you can more or less shoot them down if you're not interested in them.
All right. Try me.
Wrestling.
No, don't care. I watched a little bit in high school, but, like, I don't really watch it anymore. Once a year, if someone's like, hey, I'm having a Royal Rumble party, I will go. And I've probably been to, like, one pro wrestling, like, house party, like, one a year, maybe a little less. Like, I probably missed a year for the past, like, 3 or 4 years. But, like, I'm not – it's just, like, a social thing for me. Like, I think of wrestling, like, it's not for me, and I can't really speak to it.
Yeah. Comic books.
Oh, yeah, I did comic books. Oh, yeah.
Are you up to date, or do you just enjoy the...
I read a handful of graphic novels a year. This year, I actually probably read a lot more than I usually do. I just got into Brian K. Vaughan and Ed Brubaker, and, like, I couldn't stop reading their stuff. But I usually, like, read a handful of graphic novels a year, but I'm not an every Wednesday at the comic book store picking up my books. I know it's an every Wednesday. Is it still Wednesdays? Maybe it was Tuesdays.
Wednesdays, yep.
But I did do that when I was, like, for a year or two, when I was, like, in middle school. So, like, I'm familiar with the concept, and, like, I can make the joke. But, I really like comic books, and if I hear something's good, I'll check it out. But, like, I can't read them 22 pages at a time.
Yeah. It's, when you pick them up weekly, you spend $5 for minutes.
It's insanely expensive. And also, like... one of the things I've really been enjoying this year is I'm reading things that are already done. Like, I can't stand reading, like, someone recommended Southern Bastards to me, which was excellent, and I loved it, and, like, I'm like, now it's gonna be, like, year, but, like, I'm not, it's like, I can't.
You just want to get it over with. It's like, it's like Netflix.
Yeah, I guess. It's just, like, it takes so long. Like, the drip of the pace of release for comic books, I find very unsatisfying.
It's, like, 20 pages per month. That is not steady.
I guess if you're, like, a regular reader, the breadth of it covers it. You're reading, like, a lot of books every week. But, like, I'm not into comic books to read a lot of books every week. If I hear something's good or there's something I'm into, I'll read it. But I'm not going to be reading, like, any... I don't like comic books enough to be reading anything less than, like, excellent comic books.
Yeah. And
a lot of it's not the stuff that comes out week to week, you know?
Yeah. Like the classics, like Killing Joke and all that stuff. And then third and final, I would guess, would be classified as a nerdy topic, tabletop games.
Oh, boy. That's another thing I've gotten more into lately. I'm really into board games. Really into board games. I maybe as much as I am into video games at the moment, to be honest. I really like board games. I've really found, discovered my love of them over the past years, as I think a lot of people have.
Well, I think, like, a big thing of it is the fact that there's such a... Well, Nintendo is really just the last bastion of local co-op. So more and more people are turning to...
That's interesting. That's really interesting. I hadn't thought of that. You know, I think that's interesting. There are a lot of, I would say, great indie games on Steam that are great local co-op games. I'm talking Sports Friends. I'm talking Towerfall. I'm talking Overcooked, I think it's called, or Outchef.
Yes,
it's Overcooked. Something like that. Yeah. That game's really great. I'm on my computer. Let me just pop up my Steam library for a sec, because I love this type of game. So there are people doing it other than Nintendo, though it's definitely not like a default. Like,
it's not a AAA thing anymore.
Yeah, that's for sure. Let me just see, just because I have it right here. Oh, the Jackbox games are really fun. Speedrunners is a really good game. I'm not seeing any others right now, but those games are all really fun. I mean,
there's plenty of examples.
Yeah. Towerfall is unbelievable. I love Towerfall. Anyway, so those games still exist, but that's a piece of it. But I think another piece of it that has really made me interested is I see a lot of games that are not. Don't have a lot of gameplay anymore, and this is what we were just talking about. And, like, board games are all gameplay, and that's, like, what I like about video games. And, like, the thing I like about video games and the thing I like about board games are actually pretty similar, which is, like, I like interesting gameplay mechanics, and, like, when they click in my head and I see, like, what makes them fun and interesting, that is, like, really fun for me. Like, I like learning new video games, and I like learning new board games. I have friends who are, like, so sick of me, like, explaining board games, you know? But I like that. I actually like learning new board games, and, like, I like the moment where it clicks. And a lot of, like, gameplay stuff, a lot of that's, like, actually missing in big AAA video games. And, like, that's what board games are all about. It's almost like... you know, it really boils gameplay down to, like, its bare essentials. And, like, you have no graphics, and, like, you got to make your gameplay interesting just on its own terms. And
it's what's kept Dungeons & Dragons around for all this time.
Well, Dungeons & Dragons, a nerd confession of mine is I've never played Dungeons & Dragons. But also, it is, it's a little different, as I understand it, in that Dungeons & Dragons is not the kind of game that actually interests me, because I like games of strategy and tactics and dice and shit. But Dungeons & Dragons is kind of like a role-playing exercise, and it seems like a lot of it's like storytelling and imagination and world-building, and that's cool, but like I actually like games with like hard rules where like you have to like figure out a little puzzle and like there's a winner... And that's the end of it. And which is not to say that I, not to put down Dungeons & Dragons, just that, like, the thing that attracts me, I don't know, like, it's got a lot of rules, but it's not really a game, is it?
I'd say it's a game made by the players. Right. So it's as much of a game as you want it to be. Like, somebody could, a dungeon master, as it were, could sit down for 3 weeks solid, make this absolutely rigid campaign that you cannot get out of, or some guy could pick up the rule book, walk over to his friend's house, and play 100% freeform.
Right. I mean, that's cool, and it's interesting, and I'm sure there's like a variant of it that I would think is fun, but I really do like games with like clear victory conditions and like gameplay loops and engine building and things like that.
Yeah, what would you say is your at the moment, your favorite tabletop game that you could just keep going back to it whenever you go to your friend's house or showing it to them? Like,
yeah.
What would your favorite?
Well, I'll give you six. I'm just kidding. I'll give you two. We'll leave it at that. One is Codenames is a really good game right now. It just won the Spiel des Jahres, which I think is how you say that, which is a German board gaming award. It's the only board gaming award that matters as far as I can tell. And it is a... interesting game in that it's a little actually closer to Taboo than Catan or whatever. Like, there's no, like, action tokens and resource cards. Like, it's like a word game with cards, and, like, any human can play it. And it's a really fun and interesting party game. It's called Codenames, and there's also Codename Pictures, and I think they're both great. The other one that's a little more board gamey that I'm into at the moment is probably Five Tribes, which is a game that's, like, a year or two old. It's pretty new, I think. And it's kind of like, you know, Mancala, which is like a ancient African board game.
Yeah.
Well, it's like Mancala. It's Mancala-ish in that you have this board, and there's it's Arabian themed, and then there's like you have different colored pieces, and you kind of like there's a little puzzle about how you can move them around, and it's a pretty interesting, engaging game. It's like just the right amount of hard for me.
Mm-hmm. And it's not like some board games where it's just 8 minutes done, and it's also not Risk where you can spend three different play sessions on the same game.
I have a few games that are like 10 minute games that are good, like dessert games as I call them. But I'd say 60 to 90 minutes is probably my sweet spot, and that's what this is. It's like a little. It's less than Risk. It's like 90 minutes. And a lot of these games, a lot of these like European style board games also are pretty good at like having a time limit and ending wrapping themselves up, unlike Monopoly or Risk, which can, you know, really drag on.
Oh yeah, there was a recent Risk expansion that literally played on the idea of coming back to the exact same campaign time after time after time.
Oh, is that Risk Legacy?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, I actually did a playthrough of that with some friends, one of whom was Pat Castles, and so the deal with that is it is part of, oh god, this is a whole other thing. It's like part of this legacy thing, it's this legacy board games, and yeah, there's like these rules where it's not an ongoing campaign, it's like a new game every time, but you can do things over the course of the game that affect future playthroughs. Like, you can, like, name something on the board, and then, like, whenever you go there forever for the rest of time, like, you get a permanent bonus. And some of the cards are, like, after you use this card, like, rip it up and throw it in the garbage. But then, there's, like, what actually makes it really fun, though, is that there's, like, new rules, and the game actually evolves, and, like, it says things like, after the first person who... First of all, you got to play all the time only with the same people. It's like, we are playing a season of this board game together, like us five. Mm-hmm. And so, like, it's like the first time someone wins their second game, like, open this packet. And, like, add some new cards because you've been throwing some out. And, like, it adds new stickers to the board so that there's, like, new territories. And, like, some of them even have, like, new pieces and new factions. And, you know, I actually thought I think Risk is a bad game, and I didn't love playing Risk, but like it was always opening up a new packet and like reading the new rules was like always very exciting and very fun. And like it's also like sci-fi themed, so all the factions are really different, and like the pieces are cool, so like it's very fun. It's fun. And like, even though but Risk is kind of not good, so like the center of it wasn't very fun. But I know that they did a Pandemic Legacy, which I've heard is a lot better. And also another game, I think, that's called Seafall. I'm not sure if it's Seafall or Seafall Legacy, but it's the same system, but not based on a pre-existing board game. So I think that like model of board game is pretty interesting, even though I thought Risk Legacy was a complete drag by the end.
Well, it's more like a living board game, but then that kind of presents the issue of you're kind of done with your purchase upon the first playthrough. Once you've used up all these things, they're used up.
That's true, but I've bought board games that I played less than 10 times. You know, like, if you buy, let's say Risk is Legacy is $50, it might even be $60. It's got a ton of plastic pieces in it. But, like, you play it 10 times, like, I'd say you've gotten your money's worth out of it, you know? Like, I'd say if you get, like, 10 one-hour playthroughs of that game, you know, five people, $6 a playthrough. I'm ballparking the numbers here, but to me, that's like a pretty reasonable deal. Like, if I buy a board game, like Five Tribes doesn't explode. Like, there's nothing that's ruining the board. If I play that game 10 times before I die, I'll be thrilled. It's just like, you know, it's hard to get that stuff out on the table. And so that doesn't. Yes, that's a built-in limitation, but like, there's a lot of there. It's a trade-off, right? But like, you get all this other stuff in return.
Yeah, you're definitely getting your money's worth, but 10 years down the road, you're probably not playing it again.
Yeah. So it's a different thing, and I think that's really interesting. Like, to make a legitimately different thing within board games, which have been around for thousands of years or whatever. Not exactly, but you know what I mean. That I think that's pretty interesting. So good on them.
Yeah. That's pretty much all my questions. Thank you so much for being my first interviewer, interviewee, Jeff Rubin. Next, I guess for the people who are listening, I'll be talking to somebody on DeviantArt who does adoptables, and I'll explain what the heck that is next time. I'll see you all guys next time.
Thanks so much.